Hello and good afternoon, everyone.
My name is Muneeb Beg.
And I am Asfa Sultan and will be your host for today's event.
Aaj 4 April, Asia ke azim rehnuma Zulfikar Ali Bhutto ki 40th barsi ka din. Woh rehnuma jisne Millat-e-Islamiya ko ek platform pe ikhatta kiya. February 1974 Pakistan mein Islami Sarbrahi Conference ka inkaad Shahid Zulfikar Ali Bhutto ka ek aisa karnama tha jisse muddaton yaad rakha jayega. शहीद जुल्फ़िकार अली भुट्टो एक फ़लसफ़े का नाम है, एक नज़रिए का नाम है, जिसने गरीबों को सियासी शऊर, जिसने नौजवानों में एक नया जज्बा, एक नई उमंग बेदार की, जिसने पाकिस्तान को एटमी कुव्वत बनाने की जानिब पहला कदम रखा. ऐसे रहनुमा बहुत कम पैदा होते हैं. जुल्फ़िकार अली भुट्टो की शहादत पर उबैदुल्ला अलीम ने क्या खूब कहा था, अंदर भी ज़मीं की रोशनी हो, अंदर भी ज़मीं की रोशनी हो, मट्टी में चिराग रख दिया है. आइए देखते हैं जुल्फिकार अली भुट्टो की जिंदगी पर मबनी एक शॉर्ट वीडियो.
And now we'd like to call Madam Shahnaz Wazir Ali on stage to pay homage to Shahid Zulfikar Ali Bhutto.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Today we are starting our Zab Media Festival's program of this afternoon and evening with a small session of about half an hour or so on a tribute to Shahid Zulfikar Ali Bhutto. Aaj unki 40th shahadat ki barsi hai aur aaj waise to zabist band hai unke barsi ke ehtiram mein aur hukumat-e-Sindh ne bhi ek elan kiya hai कि आज सारे दफातर बंद होंगे और सारे तालीमी इदारे भी बंद होंगे और ये एक एहतराम उनके एहतराम का तरीका है हुकूमत-ए-सिंध की तरफ से इशारा कि इस दिन में जहाँ भी ये लोग हों इकट्ठे हों ख़ासतौर पे मैं कहूँगी जो नौजवान नस्ल है उसके लिए ये पैगाम ज़्यादा मौसू है कि वो आज शहीद जुल्फ़िकार अली भुट्टो के बारे में कुछ हम बातें करें. So it is with this in mind that the Media Science Department, and I want to thank Mr. Taimur Suri, Ms. Mehver Saidi, and each and every one of the media faculty that is sitting here, along with all those who have organized the Zab Media Festival, and every one of the students who are here from the Media Science Department. I want to thank each one of you and recognize each one of you, and Shah Jahan especially, for all the enormous work that you have done, and hope that we can spend a few moments to reflect upon one of the most significant revolutionary leaders of our time. And I'll share with you some of my personal experiences, share a short presentation with you on his life, although nothing is actually ever adequate to capture what Zulfikar Ali Bhutto was. One of the things I feel very, have felt very strongly over the years is that for us as Pakistanis and for a young state, we're about 70 years old now, the powerful impact that Zulfikar Ali Bhutto had on Pakistan, on its thinking and its politics, on its economy, on its place in the comity of nations, both at the level of the Islamic countries, the regional countries, as well as the international stage. And also how dominant he is despite 40 years. And I know many times you will meet people who are very, very strongly pro-Bhutto. You will also meet people who are anti-Bhutto. And that is everybody's right. And as you know that we are, as a university, we encourage everyone to have their own thoughts and their own judgment. So if you're a supporter of the ideology of the Pakistan People's Party or a supporter of Mr. Bhutto and his vision and his ideology, or you disagree with him, and you may disagree with him on many things, on many of his policies, but he is a defining leader in Pakistan's history, because the emotions either for Mr. Bhutto or even against Mr. Bhutto are very powerful and very strong. Now, why do I say that he is a defining leader? Some of you may have been students of history. I think almost every media student is a student of history, because how do you get into people's emotions and thoughts and feelings unless you've read a little bit about what we are in the past? अपने माजी को देखकर ही अपना जो हाल है, जो ये वक्त है, वो समझ आता है. अपनी लेगेसी, अपनी ट्रेडिशंस, अपनी तारीख जो है, जब तक उसको आप पढ़ेंगे नहीं, समझेंगे नहीं, तो आप इस वक्त जो आप फर्द हैं, एक एक शख्स जो इस कमरे में बैठा हुआ है, उसको अपने आप को समझने के लिए बहुत ज़रूरी है कि वो गहरी नज़र डाले कि मैं किस रवि से आया हूँ, मैं किस धारे से आया हूँ. Which stream do I come from? What is that intellectual thought and stream that I come from? My parents, my grandparents, my great-grandparents, my community. It doesn't matter ethnically what you are. You can be Sindhi, Punjabi, Pathan, Gujarati, Muslim, non-Muslim. But all of us have a very, very strong line of history. And that line of history is not just physically your parents or your grandparents, but it is what they represented through their lives and their generations and the culture and the society and the political thought that they had at the times that they lived. Because each one of us is influenced by many people. Sometimes you're influenced very strongly by your parents. Sometimes you're influenced very strongly by your teachers, by other older people, by a poet, by Rumi, by Fairs, by Iqbal, by Ghalib, by T.S. Eliot, by any of the writers, poets, novelists. Sometimes you're influenced by events. So all of us have a certain view of life, and that view of life is molded and cultured and influenced by many things that happen. So many of us who were students in the 1960s, and I was a student in the American University in the 60s, early 60s. We lived at a time when the Vietnam War was a very prime issue. You were living at a time when the war in Syria, the war in Afghanistan, the war in Iraq, what is happening in Palestine, these are strong defining moments of history. When we were in university, I was there at the time when President John F. Kennedy was the president, and I have been to the White House two or three times, and we had a chance to meet him and Mrs. Jacqueline Kennedy also. They used to invite Asian students and all regions of the world. And at that time, the Vietnam War was a very, very important point on which students protested. Being in America, they protested against American imperialism. They protested against this superpower dominating a small country like Vietnam and pitching all its forces, hundreds of thousands of people and billions of dollars, to determine the fate of Vietnam, to protect it from what they said were the communists. So the war in Vietnam was very important for us as students. And it was in the 60s that some very important events were taking place in Pakistan. Because from 1958 to 1968 was Field Marshal General Muhammad Ayub Khan. You all remember that. And at that time, there was a young man in the cabinet of Field Marshal Ayub Khan, and that was Zulfikar Ali Bhutto. He was not even 30, and he had become the foreign minister. And he had begun to realize that Pakistan was standing at the crossroads, particularly when Ayub Khan was bringing about a system of controlled democracy. I'm just giving you small snippets. Of course, you will see some of it in the presentation, but you'll remember a great deal more. And it was at that time that Zulfikar Ali Bhutto probably felt deeply and strongly enough to begin to formulate his political views. Although he had been to Berkeley, California, he'd been to Oxford, and he belonged to a feudal family of Sindh, but his thinking was molded by the great Titans of the time. Tito in Yugoslavia, Sukarno in Indonesia, Fidel Castro in Cuba, 5-6 prominent world leaders, and of course the Chinese leadership, that spoke about people. Hakuk, awam ke hakuk. Masavat ka maashra. Ye jo sari cheezein thi, in cheezon ka asar Zulfikar Ali Bhutto pe bahut tha. Aur unhone jab ye dekha ke General Field Marshal ya General Ayub Khan bahut sari compromises kar rahe hain aur controlled democracy lane ki koshish kar rahe hain, to unki ye political thinking, political ideology jo hai wo badi tezi se define hoti gayi ki kya humne is system ko support karna hai ya humne is system ko radd karna hai. How many of you know what controlled democracy and basic democracies were? Just raise your hand. Are you familiar with what was basic democracy? No. Okay. Today, the way democracy works is that each one of you has a vote. How many in this hall are over 18 years of age? You're almost 100% voters here, right? So every time an election takes place, you have a right to vote. But what Ayub Khan did was, he said, I don't believe in everybody having a right to vote. I'm going to create a structure that there will be indirect voting. Only a few people will be allowed to contest elections, and not everybody will be allowed to vote. And they'll, to simplify things, there will be a lower level of councils, union councils, where you can cast your vote. So whoever wins from that union council, small unit, will actually cast the vote for the National Assembly. So you yourself today can cast a vote for the MNA. Right? And cast a vote for the MPAs. But at that time, people were deprived in Pakistan. You go back and talk to your parents, talk to your grandparents, they'll tell you what was Ayub Khan's basic democracy. It was an indirect so-called democracy. Actually, what it did was it cut at the very, very foundations and the roots of an egalitarian society and the very concept of equal citizenship for all. Today we fight for rights of women, rights of the minorities, rights of the oppressed, rights of the deprived. But at that time, everybody was deprived. None of us were allowed to vote directly for our leaders. So that was one thing that had a strong impact, and Zulfikar Ali Bhutto stood up against it. Secondly, he was very conscious of international politics. And ultimately, he played on that stage of international politics in a very, very powerful and very strong ideological manner. So he felt that within the country, we were deprived of democracy, and there was elitism. A few families were getting all the perks and benefits. 22 families of Pakistan controlled 75% of the assets and wealth and investment of Pakistan. I'm sure some of them you've heard of. Sehgals, Dauds, Adamjis, Valikas, many other big families like that. There were 22 such families. They controlled the industry. And at the same time, within Pakistan, while all of this was happening, an unequal economic system, an unequal political system, and a lot of control, At the same time, internationally, Pakistan was being positioned in a very awkward, very, very difficult position because of the situation with Tashkent, at the Tashkent Agreement. So he took a very strong stand on Tashkent, again Ayub Khan, against Ayub Khan. And to simplify things, because this is not a history class, just to simplify things, that Shahid Zulfikar Ali Bhutto stood up to the dictator, General Muhammad Ayub Khan, and said, I will not be silent any longer because you have sold out Pakistan's interests at Tashkent, and I will go to the people. So that was the first time he decided he would go to the people, and it was in the 60s. So there was a lot of foment in the world, as I've already told you, that with the Vietnam War and many other things, there was a rising trend for people's movements, for democratic movements. And he was on the crest of that wave. He was very, very strong in terms of his view of how to lead Pakistan. And subsequently, of course, he broke with Ayub, established the People's Party, went to the people. That in itself is the defining moment of the change of Pakistan's politics. Out of the drawing rooms, into the open fields and the streets. Drawing room mein se nikal ke ye to aapne suna hoga gali mohalle aur kheton ki mein wo siyasat leke gaye wo un logon ke paas gaye jo gareeb the jo mutawasit tabqa tha jinki awaaz nahi thi jo be awaaz the aur jo taaqatwar nahi the jo pise hue log the jo oppressed log the aur unki awaaz unhone uthai isliye he is known as a revolutionary leader and he talks about the awam and the people. So today we remember a man who had such a powerful effect on Pakistan. Subsequently, of course, elections were fought. There was the whole tragedy and debacle of East Pakistan. And there may be you may have two views about it, but certainly that's part of our history. Pakistan is no longer what it was pre-1971. Uske baad jab unki hukumat aayi, phir unhone bahut sare reforms bhi kiye, and then you know what happened. After the nuclear program was launched and he was removed from power through an illegal, unconstitutional coup. So we'll just take a quick look at a few pictures I think I've been able to put together. You can see the people around him. So he moved, just please, can we go back? Thoda sa peeche jaye shuru se. Ab aap jab bhi dekhenge, aap dekhenge unke ird-gird jo log hain, wo aam log hain. Wo ameer tareen industrialist nahi hain. Wo hamesha awam ke paas, logon ke paas jaya karte the. और उनको एहसास था कि ये जो महरूम तबका है पाकिस्तान का इसकी आवाज़ किसी ना किसी ने तो उठानी है तो आप हज़ारों तस्वीरें उनकी हैं उनकी तहरीरें हैं तकरीरें हैं तस्वीरें हैं जिसमें इस चीज़ की गवाही दी जाती है और आगे चलें जस्ट वन मिनट हियर आई विल नॉट टेक टाइम टू गो ओवर दिस रिफॉर्म्स बट फॉर एनीबडी हु इज़ रियली इंटरेस्टेड आई वुड सजेस्ट दैट जस्ट टू नो योर हिस्ट्री Go into Mr. Bhutto's life. Our library has got all his books, every book that he's written and books written on him. And you will be able to see the labor reform, education reform, health reform, several other reforms, civil service, land reforms, industrial reforms, several reforms that he brought about. In addition to many landmark things, as you know, there was the nuclear program. Until today, it is because of Mr. Bhutto that we have a nuclear program. And we also had the Ordnance Factory, steel mill, the cultural foundations, the book foundations, the academies, various cultural entities, Pakistan National Arts Council, Karachi Arts Council, many of these things that you have today, actually institutions were established at that time. As you can see that he was influenced in his political thinking when he was a student both at Berkeley and at Oxford. He read political thought and political history and political thought. That's really important, I think, for anybody who may be interested. It's worth going back and reading some of his very, very prominent writings through the 60s and 70s. He initiated the program. There's again, a very, very important part of our history that you need to know how the program got started, who were the people that were involved, and why this program, the nuclear program, ultimately was the cause for the United States of America to be very unhappy with Mr. Bhutto. And that really was the conspiracy that was laid to topple his government. They did not want a strong nuclear-armed state that had convened the Islamic summit, had called all the great leaders. There was Gaddafi from Libya who was here, Boumediene from Algeria who was here, Assad from Syria who was here, from Iraq, I'm forgetting who was here, but one of the leaders, whoever was the leader from Iraq at that time, Shah Faisal from Saudi Arabia, he was here. So all the major Muslim countries of the world collected together in Lahore, as you know, for the 1973 Islamic Summit. These words, I don't know how many of you have ever heard this. Even if we have to eat grass, we will make the nuclear bomb. We have no other choice. Raise your hand if you've ever heard this before. Even if we have to eat grass, we will make the nuclear bomb. Now, of course, there may be I hope all of us are pro-peace. We don't want war. We as a nation, culturally, are not a people who want war. We want peace. We want to live, you know, we coexist with other nations of the world. But this was a very vital thing for Pakistan, because at that time, no Islamic country had the nuclear bomb. Until today, it's known as the Islamic bomb. So this was a deterrent. Arming Pakistan with a nuclear bomb and a nuclear facility was a deterrent against anybody that would have any offensive designs against Pakistan. And Mr. Bhutto was the person who laid the groundwork for that. And how many of you have heard of Dr. Abdul Qadir Khan? Good. All right. He was working in Holland, and he was not a nuclear physicist, a metallurgist. He was a metallurgist. And he was working in a very high, sensitive security facility in Holland. And he was persuaded to come back, and he brought back a lot of the designs for the nuclear bomb. And Dr. Professor Abdus Salam, how many of you have heard of Dr. Professor Abdus Salam? I'm very happy to hear that. Because unfortunately he had to leave Pakistan because he was an Ahmadiyya Qadiani. But nevertheless, he was a Nobel Prize winner, Pakistan's first Nobel Prize winner. So Pakistan became an atomic power, of course, in 1998, when in Mian Nawaz Sharif's government we detonated, and we showed that we had the nuclear capability. You see this, here's the Islamic summit. I think you can see, can you see Yasser Arafat right there on the left side with the dark glasses? Yeah. And you can see the other leaders. Gaddafi sitting right next to Mr. Bhutto. And then there's Shah Faisal. And several others are sitting in that row. It has never happened before. Never before have all the Muslim leaders of the world come together on one platform like they did. So the rising Muslim power and coalition, along with Pakistan's secret program of the nuclear bomb, became a threat to the West. And that's how the United States of America began to reposition itself. And as you know, there's a very famous saying of Henry Kissinger, who was the state, United States, the equivalent of a foreign minister of the United States. And he said, "We will make an example of you." Those were the famous words of Mr. Kissinger, that we'll make an example of you. And ultimately, General Ziaul-Haq moved against Mr. Bhutto, as you know, in 1977. He deposed Mr. Bhutto in 1977. Thank you. July. I think you're familiar with that. Are you familiar when the democratic civilian government of Mr. Bhutto was deposed? You remember that in 1970, from your history books? Should remember it, okay? Aaj ki jo jumhuriyat hai, aaj ki jo freedom hai, aaj ka jo maasha hai, aaj ka Pakistan hai, ये इस तरह हमेशा नहीं था. इसमें 3-4 दफ़ा डिक्टेटर्स आए हैं और उन्होंने सारी चीज़ें रद्द कर दी हैं, आइन को, कवानीन को, एक माशरे की सोच बदल दी है. तो 1977 में जब जुलाई में 5th of July वॉज द कू व्हेन मिस्टर भुट्टो वॉज इन हिज रेजिडेंस इन रावलपिंडी एंड ही वॉज अरेस्टेड दैट नाइट बाय अ फ्यू कमांडोज एंड जनरल ज़ियाउल हक़'स ऑर्डर्स. And he was taken to Rawalpindi. So when that coup took place, of course, nobody thought that there would be a complete change of track of Pakistan's history after a good solid 5 and a half years of the Pakistan People's Party government, which was a social democratic government. So I think it is important for you to remember there has been a very, very bitter, long struggle behind a free and democratic Pakistan today. Many of us have fought on the streets. We have gone to jail, we've gone to thanas. I have done that myself against the military dictator. We spoke for the rights of the people, the rights of labor, the right of students, the right of the hari, the right of the peasant, the right of the poet, the intellectual, the writer, the thinker, the artist, the poet. This is your community, thinkers, writers, poets, creators, filmmakers, directors. You want a free environment to live in. You do not want a dictated and controlled ideological state. And we've had to fight 11 long years for that. But General Ziaul Haq did not allow Mr. Bhutto to live. And by 1979, on the 4th of April, he was executed early in the morning without telling anybody and informing, rejecting all international efforts. Every single leader of the third world, every single leader, appealed to General Ziaul Haq and sent messages that Mr. Bhutto's life should be spared, he should not be executed, and that executing the most popular leader of Pakistan would bring severe consequences to Pakistan. But Ziaul Haq did not bother about it. Because you might have heard this phrase, kabar ek hai, usme ya Bhutto jayega ya main jaunga. Ek kabar mein kaun jayega? So he could not allow Mr. Bhutto to live. After he had deposed him, unconstitutionally, illegally he had deposed him. So it was an act of treason. And an act of treason is punishable by death. So General Ziaul Haq knew that either the noose would be around his neck or he had to put it on Mr. Bhutto's neck. But Mr. Bhutto felt very strongly, and you can read that last part when he said that he was accused of murdering Mr. Kasuri, Ahmed Ali Kasuri's father. He had no hand in that at all. And the way that the trial was conducted, it was a completely manipulated trial, completely manipulated, with taking direct orders from Ziaul Haq. There was no evidence whatsoever. This was a judicial execution. It was a judicial execution without any evidence of Mr. Bhutto being involved in the attack on Mr. Kasuri. And yet these judges went ahead. There was one dissenting judge, and a very honorable judge, but the rest of them went ahead, and Maulvi Mushtaq was the Chief Justice of the Lahore High Court, where Mr. Bhutto was sentenced. I have attended that trial. I have attended it for at least 23 or 24 days. I have seen Mr. Bhutto standing in the katera. And I'll tell you how I did it, because it connects with the media. It was very controlled. आप में से कितने हैं जो लाहौर गए हुए हैं? वेरी गुड. कितने हैं जिन्होंने लाहौर हाई कोर्ट देखा है? अच्छा, हाई कोर्ट के अंदर कभी गए हैं? हाई कोर्ट का कमरा काफ़ी बड़ा कमरा है, बहुत तारीखी इमारत है और एक बड़ी ऊंचे छत है, बहुत ज़्यादा जगह नहीं है. जितने लोग तकरीबन यहाँ पे बैठे हुए हैं, तकरीबन उतने ही या उससे कम लोग बैठ सकते हैं जो उनकी सीट्स होती हैं, जहाँ पे ज़्यादातर वकला बैठते हैं, लॉयर्स बैठते हैं.
और एक साइड पे प्रेस बैक्ट था और एक साइड पे भुट्टो साहब का कटहरा था जहाँ पे भुट्टो साहब और उनके साथ जो को अक्यूज थे वो बैठा करते थे बैठते थे और साथ उनके सिविल कपड़ों में जो इंटेलिजेंस एजेंसीज के लोग हैं वो हमेशा साथ होते थे. तो जब मैं चाह रही थी कि मैं जाके किसी ना किसी तरह हम भी पहुँचें वहाँ पर देखें तो इजाज़त बिल्कुल नहीं थी. इट वॉज़ अ वेरी वेरी सिवियरली कंट्रोल्ड एनवायरमेंट. Roads were blocked for miles around the High Court. Lots of police barricades, lots of police forces, the Punjab police force, which did not allow anybody to go through. So I found, through some family connections, somebody in the media and in the press, and I got myself a press card. So some of you who are studying journalism and know the, obviously all of you know the media world. So journalists are allowed to go in to cover that. So that's how I got in. And I sat in that press box where the gallery was, where must have been about 35, 40 people tightly squashed. That's how we had to be there very early in the morning. So practically at about 6 o'clock in the morning, we would be standing outside the High Court to be able to get in. And I myself have witnessed that trial. Masood Mahmood was the first witness that was called, and subsequently the others as well. So manipulation, historical manipulation, and a historical tragedy of the greatest order occurred on the 4th of April 1979. 40 saal ho chuke hain aur aaj bhi hum Zulfikar Ali Bhutto ki baat karte hain. 40 saal ke baad हम में से कई ऐसे लोग हैं जिनको ये भी नहीं याद होगा कि इस वक्त कैबिनेट में कितने लोग बैठे हैं, उनके क्या क्या नाम हैं. लेकिन सबको याद है ज़ुल्फ़िकार अली भुट्टो, लीडर ऑफ़ द पीपल्स पार्टी, फाउंडर ऑफ़ द पीपल्स पार्टी, एंड अ मैन हु स्टूड फॉर अ सोशल डेमोक्रेटिक सिस्टम इन पाकिस्तान. हु वॉज द एट हिज इन हिज टेन्योर द 1973 कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन विच इज स्टिल होल्ड्स इन पाकिस्तान was passed and promulgated, and he was the man who spoke for the rights of the people, and he was the man who spoke for the third world. He spoke for the third world non-aligned movement in which there were African countries, South American countries, and Asian countries. So I think when you're talking of people's leaders and you read other the history of other countries and other nations, it is important. Not very big, the book is quite thin. You can just read it, pick it up from the library, read a little bit about it. It's important to know one's history. And that's today the reason why we are commemorating him. We remember a man who said, death cannot kill me. The execution cannot kill me. It does not deter me. The hangman's noose will not deter me. I am not afraid of it because I am a man of history. History will remember me. So I will not die in history. So you can kill me in the Kot Lakhpat jail, you can kill me in Adiyala jail, you can kill me in any jail in Pakistan. They executed him at about 3:30 in the morning on the 4th of April 1979 in Adiyala jail in Rawalpindi. And his body was then taken by C-130 to Gadi Khuda Baksh. And his daughter, Benazir Bhutto Sahiba, and his wife, Begum Nusrat Bhutto, were not allowed to see him at the end. Not allowed to be with the janaza, and he was buried in Gadi Khuda Baksh. And this is where he's buried. So today, this is where hundreds of thousands of people will go to pay tribute and homage to him. And that's why I hope that this very, very short time that we have had to speak about him will be important for you, and I hope you will remember it, because you yourself have to have an interest in picking up a book and reading about him. See some documentaries. In this world of internet, you can read about him very easily. It doesn't take very long. But it really is important to know that if that day had not occurred, if on the 5th of July 1977 he had not been deposed and the coup had not occurred, Pakistan would be a different country. There would be no Zia-ul-Haq, no period, 11 years of dictatorship,
and the war in Afghanistan that has totally destroyed us because of the rise of the religious parties, the Taliban, the Kalashnikov culture, the drugs, millions of Afghan refugees. Until today, we are so deeply involved and so closely connected with what happens in Afghanistan in terms of conflict. And Pakistan's state has been ideologically shifted from its moorings since 1977 and more so since 1979. So these are very important historical moments. And while we sit here, nange pair, और धूपों में देर काफ़ी फासले चल चल के लोग इस वक्त गढ़ी खुदा बख्श में मौजूद हैं हज़ारों की तादाद में, औरतें भी, जवान भी, बूढ़े भी, सारे सिंध के लोग, पंजाब के, खैबर पख्तूनख्वा के, जहाँ जहाँ से लोग आ सकते हैं वो वहाँ पे जा रहे हैं. और पीपल्स पार्टी ज़ाहिर है वहाँ पे होगी, बिलावल भुट्टो भी तकरीर करेंगे. And I know that this is also a time for the Pakistan People's Party to rethink a lot of things. I think that's also important. It needs to reposition itself so that it does become a party that reflects your point of view. For the youth, we have to have a strategic repositioning of the Pakistan People's Party as well. And this is also very much consciously a process that has started within the People's Party. So thank you very much for listening. And so this is Zabis' tribute to our founder, because we are Shaheed Zulfikar Ali Bhutto Institute of Science and Technology. So more than any other university.
Thank you, Madam President. Now we would like you to please place the bouquet at the remembrance podium.
I would also like to request Ms. Mehvis Zahra Zaidi and Mr. Taimur Suri to place the bouquet at the remembrance podium.
Now I would like to request Sir Shah Jahan Saleem, Sir Saqlain Zaidi and Sir Irfan Khairi to please place the bouquet at the remembrance podium.
From the batch of 2019, I would request Fasi to please place the bouquet at the remembrance podium. Thank you, everyone. We will take a short break, but everybody is requested to remain seated. Thank you.
Students.